I want all of you to close your eyes and imagine a day from your childhood. I want you to imagine a day where it might have been sunny outside, where you might have been blowing bubbles. I want you to hold on to this image of blowing bubbles for a couple of seconds. What if I were to tell you that these very bubbles can be the key to providing us clean drinking water in the future? I know this might sound ridiculous, but this is the reality. Now, for all of us, bubbles might represent a sense of childhood wonder and excitement, and you probably think that you know everything there is about bubbles. But do you? Enter nanobubbles. Nanobubbles are so tiny that they make a grain of sand look humongous. They're found everywhere, ranging from the liquids in our body to our drinking water, and they could be game-changing in giving us clean drinking water in the future. You might be wondering, well, that's all nice, but what are nanobubbles? So as I said before, nanobubbles are just really tiny bubbles. They're essentially tiny vessels of gas, typically found in liquids. Their average diameter ranges from 100 to 120 nanometers by some estimates, and that might not mean much, but to put that into perspective, microbubbles, which are the tiniest type of bubbles that we humans can see, range anywhere from 10 to 1,000 times as large as nanobubbles, which really shows you how incredibly tiny nanobubbles are. Now, from this arise a lot of interesting properties for nanobubbles. I want you to visualize opening up a can of soda. It's going to be really fizzly, and there's going to be a lot of bubbles there. Now, I want you to imagine coming back to the same can of soda 10 minutes later. A lot of these bubbles would have dissipated. Now, these type of bubbles are known as macrobubbles. They're the typical bubbles you think of when anyone mentions bubbles. They rise up to the surface and dissolve pretty quickly. Hence, they're pretty much what you probably think about. Well, nanobubbles don't act like this. Nanobubbles are very stable and they're very long-lasting in water, and this is because of their high internal pressure along with their very hard surface. This allows nanobubbles to do a lot of really great things for our water, which includes reducing the amount of chemicals to reducing the amount of pathogens. I'm going to talk about what they specifically do to our water. So firstly, they can reduce a lot of algae and pathogens. There's been a lot of studies done on various different bodies of water, ranging from lakes to streams to wastewater. And this research has shown that with the addition of nanobubbles, the concentration of pathogens and algae has gone down, which can drastically help our water. Now, I want you to think about your wastewater. I want you to think about water that, you know, it might have come right after you just wash your dishes. It's pretty nasty. You're definitely not going to want to drink this. It's because it has a lot of pollutants in it, including fats, oils, and grease, which are known as organic pollutants. Now, with the addition of nanobubbles into water, it is shown that the organic pollutants have also been able to be reduced, which can drastically help our wastewater, improving our water quality. Nanobubbles can also reduce a lot of chemicals. But most specifically and pretty notably, they can reduce a type of chemical known as PFAS, or per- and polyfluoroalkyl substances. This is a subset of chemicals that are known as the everlasting chemical. They last a really long time in our water. They're pretty hard to break down, so it's pretty notable that nanobubbles have shown promise in being able to eliminate these. So you might be wondering, okay, that's really cool, but how do they actually do this? So they work in two different ways when talking about algae and pathogens. Firstly, because nanobubbles are so tiny and they have such a high surface area, they're able to interact with and actually absorb some of these algae and pathogens. What essentially happens is they come close to these algae and pathogens and absorb them, forming an aggregate which can then rise up to the surface and be a lot more easily removed using various very simple wastewater removal methods. Another way is by increasing the dissolved oxygen concentration in water. With an increase in dissolved oxygen, this can outright change the biotic and abiotic conditions of lakes and other bodies of water, which can directly kill a lot of algae and pathogens, and can also reduce a lot of the organic pollutants. Now, when specifically talking about chemicals, the way nanobubbles are able to reduce these chemicals varies based on the specific type of chemical. But as I mentioned before, I'm going to talk about PFAS a little bit. These everlasting chemicals are known as surfactants, meaning they lie on the surface of water, hence the name surfactants. So they're what are known as amphiphilic molecules, which basically means that they have a hydrophobic tail, which does not like water, and a hydrophilic head, which likes water. So they have two halves to them, one that really doesn't like water and one that likes water, which is why it stays on the surface. What happens is nanobubbles come close to these PFAS, and they're able to come close to these hydrophobic tails, which remember don't like water. They're attracted to the gaseous part of nanobubbles, and that's what makes nanobubbles able to absorb some of these PFAS and other surfactants. What really sets nanobubbles apart from other water treatment methods is that they're very versatile. Nanobubbles, as you can see, can be used for a lot of different pollutants, which cannot be said about other water treatment methods. They're also very energy efficient, and they're also, because they're extremely stable and long-lasting in water, there's a lot more time for them to be able to absorb and reduce a lot of these contaminants, which makes nanobubbles really promising for the future. However, like with any type of new and emerging technology, there are some cons with nanobubbles, and currently that's to do with cost. So behind me is a picture of a nanobubble generator from Stony Brook University. This is really expensive and it's not too easy to actually use. However, with advancements in technology in the future, because nanobubbles are very recent and new, we can be sure that nanobubbles will help provide us clean drinking water in the future. Thank you.